Dear students, so far in this lesson, we first defined center of mass. Afterwards, we found the location of center of mass in a given body, in a given system of particles, as well as in a rigid body. We could locate center of mass using the formulas. Afterwards, we defined center of gravity and we considered some problems on center of gravity also. Now, let us have a brief review on center of mass and center of gravity. As far as definition is concerned, see in this figure, a bat is thrown. See, it is while its movement from here to here, the different parts of the bat are undergoing rotation as well as translation. But one point in the bat is undergoing pure translation. And that point which undergoes only translational motion is called center of motion. Now coming to center of gravity, see, this is a point where it can be balanced, roughly speaking. Center of gravity indicates the position where the body is to be supported and to keep the static equilibrium of the body or system. See, now here, for small bodies, center of motion and center of gravity both coincide. Only when the body is very large, they may not coincide. Why? Suppose you have taken a stick starting at Delhi city and ending at Chennai city, suppose. See, here, its center of motion, if is asked, you just locate the middle point and say this is center of motion. And the same middle point is supposed to be center of gravity also. But here, as far as center of gravity is concerned, here we considered weight of the particle. Suppose here you have taken a particle of mass m1. On this, m1g is the gravitational force. Here, suppose you have taken a particle of mass m2. On this, m2g is the gravitational force. This force tries to tilt the body clockwise. This force tries to tilt the body anti-clockwise. This provides clockwise movement or torque. This provides anti-clockwise movement or torque. So about this point, the sum of all torques will be zero. So in this way we define. So here, now the location of CG not only depends upon mass, but also it depends upon G value. But here it was for location, see, for example, XC, M1 X1 plus M2 X2 divided by M1 plus M2 for two particle system. See, here its value was depending upon just mass distribution. But here, not only mass distribution, but also G value. But here, at this place, G value is same everywhere here. So, the CM and CG may coincide. But if you have taken a stick, which is very large, one end is at Delhi and another end is in Chennai, here CM and CG may not coincide. Why means, here the G value may be some 9.78 and here the G value may be 9.81 meter per second square. So here G value here and here different. If G value changes, weight, suppose here you have taken a part having mass M. Here also you have taken a part having mass m. Its weight is mg. Its weight is mg. but g value is different, therefore mg value also will be different. Therefore the cg may not coincide. This side, Chennai side, g value is more, therefore cg may be at this place. So like this. So this is the difference between center of mass and center of gravity. So under what conditions both coincide? Both coincide and when the gravitational field is uniform. In this place, gravitational field is uniform means both coincide. If they are non-uniform, they do not coincide. Is another question is there, a very short answer question. Is it necessary that any mass should be present at center of mass of a system? For example, if we take a circular ring, the center of mass is located here, but at this point mass is not there. Now let us see, there is a question. Show that a system of particles moving under the influence of an external force moves as if the force is applied at its center of mass. It means what? A system of particles is moving. If a system of particles is moving, suppose in a system 100 particles are there and external force is applied on that. On which particle is applied the external force? Suppose 100 particles are there, on which particle the external force is applied? The external force is applied on center of mass of the system of particles. We will prove that mathematically. Now let us proceed. See, we have defined the location of center of mass like this. Position of, see, position vector of center of mass of a system of particles. Position vector of center of mass of a system of particles is given by m1r1, m2r2 plus m3r3. So if in the system of particles, suppose n particles are there, nth particle mass and its position vector, divided by total mass in this way we have defined. Now this can be written as m1r1 plus m2r2 plus so on to mnrn. See, in the denominator, total mass of the system is coming, therefore 1 by capital M. Or this capital M can be brought to left hand side so that MR is equal to M1R1, M2R2 plus so on up to MnRn. See, here in this equation M1, M2, these are masses of particles. R1, R2, these are position vectors of the above particles. the above particles. Capital M is total mass of the system of particles, and capital R is position vector of center of mass. Center of mass. Now let us differentiate equation 1 with respect to time. So here mass, total mass is constant. Differentiating that with respect to time, m1 constant, dr1 by dt. See, when a system of particles is moving, the positions of individual particles also change. R1 changes, R2 changes, Rn changes. That's why you are differentiating them. Like this. Now, rate of change of position gives velocity. Here also, rate of change of position of center of mass. So this stands for velocity of center of mass. Here m1 v1. V1 is velocity of particle 1. V2 is velocity of particle 2. Like this. So this is second equation. In this stands for velocity of center of mass, where capital V is velocity of center of mass. Now again, where capital V is velocity of center of mass. Now again we differentiate second equation with respect to time. Then m dv by dt, m1 dv1 by dt, edit. Now you see, this is rate of change of velocity. Rate of change of velocity is nothing but acceleration. So here also, this is also acceleration. So ma is equal to m1a1, m2a2, plus so on. MNAN. See, A1 is acceleration of particle 1, A2 is acceleration of particle 2. So here capital A is acceleration of center of mass. Acceleration of center of mass. See, this is third equation. Now by Newton's second law, what is Newton's second law? F is equal to ma. So here we got M1A1, M2A2, M3A3, M1A1, M2A2. See, M1A1 according to Newton's second law stands for force on particle 1, and this stands for force on particle 2, and this stands for force on center of mass. So here M1A1 is equal to F1, and that stands for force on particle 1. M2A2 stands for F2, force on particle 2, like this. And capital MA stands for force on center of mass. Force on center of mass. Now, substituting these values in the previous equation, we get here. In this equation, let us write this as it is, MA, here F1, F2, like that. F1 plus F2 plus F3, so on up to Fn, like that. So now, F1, F2, F3, these stand for forces. These stand for forces. F1 is force on particle 1. See, when you consider a system of particles, suppose this is a system of particles. Suppose this is particle 1. This is particle 1. And this is particle 2. And let us consider, see, there may be force of attraction between these two particles, and that force is treated as internal force. But on the entire system of particles, gravitational force is there. This is taken as external force. External force. The force of attraction between these two particles, see, second particle attracts the first particle towards it, first particle attracts the second particle towards it, like that. There is force of attraction in pairs according to Newton's third law. Such pair of forces are called internal forces. Internal forces. So as far as the system of particles concerned, between the particles will be internal forces, and on the system from outside will be the external force. So here, out of so many forces, all the forces can be classified into two types. Some are external forces, plus you can write this simply like this. Simply like this. This stands for sum of all the external forces, and this stands for sum of all the internal forces. So this plus this will be equal to this right hand side. Now, but by Newton's third law, action is equal to minus reaction. That is, these two forces are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. See, the sum of the two forces will be zero. So in this way, the sum of all internal forces becomes zero. So by Newton's third law, sum of all all the internal forces becomes zero. So just external force remains. Therefore, this equation reduces to MA bar is equal to F external. So this is Newton's second law. This is Newton's second law. And this equation tells what? This is a vector. Both will be in same direction because mass is a scalar. So the center of mass is accelerated in the direction of the applied external force. So this equation states that center of mass of a system of particles moves as if all the mass of the system is concentrated at the center of mass and all the external forces are applied at that point. All the external forces applied at the center of mass. Give an example to show that internal forces within the system do not affect the motion of center of mass. See here, you have fired a cracker and you have thrown away, but unfortunately that did not explode. It traveled along a parabolic trajectory and fell down on the ground. Next time you tried another cracker. When it came here, it was cracked, it was exploded. All these are pieces spreading out. So here the pieces of the cracker spread such that the center of mass of the fragments, see these are the fragments, and these fragments will have a center of mass. So that center of mass of the fragments follow the same path. Here when it explodes, center of mass of the cracker follows the same parabolic trajectory. See, that's why here you see how the fragments are symmetrically distributed from on that side and this side. They are symmetrically spreading so that the center of mass follows the same parabolic trajectory as if nothing has happened. So it means what? The forces responsible for the explosion are internal forces, and the internal forces did not disturb the trajectory of the center of mass. Even though it has exploded, center of mass followed the same path. It means what? Internal forces within the system do not affect the motion of center of mass, whether it is exploded or did not explode. The center of mass follows the same trajectory. Let us consider another example. Here, a radium nucleus is moving on. When it came here, it disintegrated into two nuclei. See, from this one, alpha particle is emitted, and the alpha particle is moving in this direction, and the remaining radon nucleus is moving in this direction. See here, this is an example of decay. So up to here, before decay, this is before decay or disintegration, here after decay. See, if no decay has occurred, its center of mass is following a horizontal straight line. But when it came here, it disintegrated into two nuclei. And these two nuclei are moving such that the center of mass of the two particle system will be on the same straight line. See here, the distance is moving here. Here the distance is moving here. Again, the center of mass will be here only. So like this, this is moving in one direction, that is moving in another direction, but center of mass will become on this line only. So in this way, so what does it mean? For decay, the internal forces are responsible. Because of internal forces, it has undergone disintegration. But the internal force could not change the motion of the center of mass. Even after disintegration, center of mass is along the same path.